can trust you. And I believe you can also trust God that we are going to have a wonderful service. Say hallelujah. Amen. I salute the executives in the house. Today is, I'm so much joyful to be here. Why? Because I believe I'll be the very first person to minister to the first years. Hallelujah. I will hear some precious in the house. Let me see you, I will. Let me see you. Amen. Today we are treating a very delicate topic. See a delicate topic. See a delicate topic. That is conforming to Christ's death. Hallelujah. Amen. Conforming to Christ's death. I keep on telling people. Take your Bibles with me to Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. Specifically verse 10. Conforming to Christ's death. Apostle Paul had been in ministry for 40 years. 40 good years. Yet this man never ceased to know God. He went to the church of Philippi in Philippians chapter 3 verse 10 and he said, that I may know him. He had been in ministry for 40 years, yet still he said, that I may know him. And the power of his resurrection. And the fellowship of his suffering. That I may be conformed to his death. This scripture I see is in four realms. Most believers always want to be in the first and the second realms. They never want to dive deep into the fourth realm. One, yes, that I may know him, number one. Number two, and the power of his resurrection. Number three, and the fellowship of his suffering. And number four, being made conformable unto his death. Say his death. Say his death. I believe that today there will be a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. That the eyes of understanding may be enlightened. That we may know the hope of his calling. And his eternal calling. And that are riches in the saints. In the name of Jesus. Most of us believers abide in Christ, but we fail to abound. We abide, but we fail to abound. Tonight we are going to abound. Let me tell you one thing. You see, the believer is likened to the Israelite. Now the Israelites left an old, condemned Adamic world. Or let me say they left Egypt. See Egypt as a well. See Pharaoh as a typology of Satan. So the Israelites, they left Egypt, which is the world. They passed through the Red Sea. Now, the Red Sea is a symbolic of something. When Jesus Christ was killed, or when he was crucified, two things came out of his side. What came out from his side? Water and blood, right? That sacrificed the Red Sea, okay? So they moved through the Red Sea, and they came onto Canaan, a land flowing in honey and milk. Milk stands for the resurrection power. Honey stands for the sweetness of life in Christ. So these people were baptized, and they came out. They died with Christ in the water. They were baptized with him. So Apostle Paul in the church of Romans, in Romans chapter 6, verse 1, down to 15, he said, how can we, who are dead to the sins, live once again in death? People of God, they are three expressions of Christ's death. Christ died for us. That is substitution. He died with us. That is baptism. And he died as us. That is identification. Tonight, we are being identified with Christ in these three main ways. He died as us. He died for us. And he died with us. But people of God, most of us, we only see the identification aspect of Christ, not the baptism aspect and not the death aspect of him. Let me tell you one thing. See, when the Israelites crossed the Red Sea onto Canaan, before they did that, the Egyptians were continually following them. They followed them and followed them until they got to the Red Sea. Let me tell you one thing. Now, in baptism, you do away with your worldly stuff. With baptism, you take away anything that has happened unto you from your worldly life. Take notes. It is the Red Sea that took away. It is the Red Sea that made the Israelite completely free. Why? Because it is the Red Sea that killed completely the Egyptians. It means that any believer who is completely immersed in Christ, that particular believer has come out or has the potential to deal away with the life of the Egyptians, symbolic of the worldly things. Being conformable unto his death. How much of yourself have you died? We die daily to live daily. We die daily to live daily. Apostle Paul entered into this realm and he said, we are exceedingly joyful in all our tribulations. We are exceedingly joyful in all our tribulations. People of God, Christ was put onto the ground as a seed, was put onto the ground as a grain. People of God, when you put something onto the ground, two things take place. Let me tell you something. Christ just didn't die for our sins, he also died for life. Say life. Say life. He died for sins and he died for life. When you put a seed on the ground, two things happen. As a seed fruit dies, the fertility comes up. So even as something is dying, Life is me impacting onto something. So when Christ was on the cross, and everything was not so much well with the system, when he was on the cross and the blood was being shed, when he was on the cross and things were taking place, at that same time, two things were being made place. As our sins were being cleansed, at that same point in time, life was being given unto us. People of God, I'm here to announce unto you that tonight, if you find yourself in this particular place, tonight, if you find yourself in this particular auditorium, and you are being made conformable unto the death of Christ, people of God, life is being imparted unto you. Life without measure is being given unto you. I believe that someone or anyone here who can hear my voice, and someone or anyone here who can see the very glory of God in picture, people of God, that you are being ushered into another realm of glory. Let me tell you something. When we say Pentecost is the day of covenant. When the Israelites, they left the land of Egypt on the 50th day, the Bible said that we are at the feet of Mount Sinai. And the Bible said that the 10 commandments were given unto them. But thanks be to God that when the 10 commandments came, 3,000 people died. It was the administration of death. But I'm here to announce unto you that when the Holy Ghost came, the Bible said 3,000 people gave their life unto Christ. What does it signify? There have been a restoration on the day of Pentecost. Let me tell you something. In the olden days, when the high priest is entering into the holiest of all, because he can die and because he can also live, this man ties a pomegranate bell at his feet or at his waist, and he enters into the holiest of all. When this man stays alive, he rings the bell and tells the people on the outer court that, yea, I am alive, or yea, everything has been made complete. And this man comes out. What does it signify? It signifies that, oh God, the righteousness of the Israelites have been accepted. So therefore, what does it mean? When Jesus Christ died, this man went into the holiest of all, according to Hebrews 9, verse 24. And when this man entered into the holiest of all, he had to signify to us here at the outer court that he's still alive. So the Bible said, when Pentecost had fully come, suddenly there came a mighty wind as a sound. What does it mean then? The sound is a ring. That's so that, yes, indeed, our Lord Jesus is alive. So when we say Pentecost, Pentecost means something that is alive. When we say Pentecost, it means some people who are alive. When we say Pentecost, it means people who are living in the very nature of God. The Bible said, hey, how can we be called the children of God? For we don't know how it shall be when it appears, but we know that when it appears, we shall be like him. And then that have this hope put up. Christ in me, the hope of glory, is hoping that I'll be like him. People of God, I'm not going to listen to you that when you find yourself in the very realm of Christ, when you find yourself being a conformable to his death, anything that you do, anything that you give up, anything that you mandate from you will be Christ like. People of God, I'm here to announce unto you that anything that has not come out of the corridors of resurrection, that particular thing is of dead works. People of God, Apostle Paul said that as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are called the sons of God. For we have not received the Spirit of bondage, but the Spirit to shout our Father, for the Father to listen unto us. Apostle Paul continued and he said, for the sufferings of this age cannot be compared to the glory that will be revealed in us. For the whole creation awaited with eager longing for the manifestation of the sons of God. For creation was subjected to futility, now by itself, but the one who subjected to hope. People of God, creation awaited us. The fullest in Katanga awaited us. The fullest in unity will await us. Things await us. But you and I come out after the death of Christ. But you and I conform to the image of his death. There is no way Rabbi can exude his life. There is no way his very essence and very radiance can come unto us. I'm here to talk unto people who are Pentecostals. I'm here to talk to a life church. I'm here to talk unto people who are their life exuding from Christ. If you are here, shout amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm here to tell you something. You see, tongues and distance in Sonia and Kasaye, God never created them. It was never a creation of God. Bible says in Genesis 3, the Bible says, to the man Adam, he said, because you have listened to your wife and you have sinned against me, today, tongues and distance shall the land produce for you. What does it mean then? It means that from the original creation of God, tongues and distance were not part. Hallelujah. I hope you are following. Now, what happened? mean that whenever you see tongues and tessels, it signifies curse unto man. So when this man called Christ Jesus was dying, in Galatians 3, verse 13, the Bible said, curse is the one who is hung on the tree. When he was on the tree, the Bible said, tongues and tessels were given unto him. He took your curse and my curse unto the cross. Whatever thing that God placed on mankind, whatever thing that God has taken from mankind, this man took it unto the cross. People of God, the Bible said, when I am weak, then, oh God, I am strong. I am is the name of God, because God said, I am that I am. So when I am weak, I am and he is strong. When I am weak on campus, and he is strong. When I am not being made conform to his letter, Elohim is strong. When things are not coming out, Elohim is stronger. People of God, you and I are not trying unto the birth of teachers. The birth of teachers is just a means to an end. And the death is the end of the means. But glory be to God. It's the resurrection. It's the end of itself. The resurrection is the end of itself. The tomb of Jesus, I mean his tomb, became the womb of God for the mass reproduction of so many glorified saints. Hey, in Bethlehem, the divine species entered into the human species. But at Calvary, the human species entered into the divine species. Through the womb of Mary, God entered into man. But through the tomb of Jesus, man entered into God. What does it mean then? Bible said, Christ became unto us the captain of our salvation through suffering. For this purpose, he who sanctifies, and we who are being sanctified, we are one with him. For this purpose, Christ is not ashamed to call us his brethren. The word brethren in Greek is adelphos, which means that twin from one group. People of God, we are Christ, but twin from a particular group. And our womb, oh God, is a tomb of him. When he came out of the womb, even the empowerment, the Jewish empowerment, could he hold him captive. Bible said, when Lazarus came out of the tomb, Jesus said, take all the empowerment of him and let him come. But when Jesus came out of the tomb, the empowerment itself, it got rotten. God rotten, he came off. What does it say then? In Acts 2 verse 24, Bible said, for death couldn't have his captive of Jesus, because God raised him up. People of God, God has raised you and I and Christ together out of the tomb, and the tomb of bondage, and the tomb of infection, and the tomb of disease, and the tomb of hardship. Christ has taken us up. We have come out of it. Shout hallelujah. Bible said in Colossians 3, verse 34, Bible said, for we are dead, or we are dead, we be died in him, or our life is hidden with him. Let's go there and read. Colossians 3, verse 4, or Colossians 3, verse 34. Put them on the Shabbat like he was high. Bible said, for you die, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life? Say Christ is my life. Say Christ is my life. Maybe personal, Christ is my life. So when Christ, who is our life, shall appear. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then we shall appear with him. What does it mean? Bible said, and for we don't know how Christ shall appear, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. And that have this hope, Christ will be the hope of glory. The hope that when Christ comes, I shall be like him. But also that they purify themselves even as he is pure. So when you are found in Christ, oh God, let me tell you something. Where was Eve before Eve came out? Where was Eve? Where was Eve? Oh, talk to me. Where was Eve? In Adam, right? So Eve was the body of Adam. Good. And Eve came out as a bride. So now the church, we are the body of Christ. We surely come out as a bride. Listen to something. For his body to come out. Sorry, Adam has to sleep for his body to come out. Jesus has to die for the body to come out. Follow me, careful. Eve ultimately became the wife of Adam. Ultimately, you and I become the bride of Christ. Now, according to Jewish Hebraism, number 23 is imperfect or incomplete. So the race are 24. Adam had one already taken off. So a void or space was created in Adam. And then one to fill the void was Eve. People of God, Christ has his rib taken off. You and I are the bride to come into that completeness of Christ. Number 24 means eternal perfection. That's why we are 24 years around the throne. People of God, Christ has 23 rips. And you and I said, when Christ died, and when Peter wanted to see what was over in the tomb, Bible said his head cover was folded, but the garment was thrown at her. What does it mean then? Christ had the head, he had finished with his cross, but you and I have the body, we have been thrown at her. We also have to be folded. People of God, you are not able to see it, to fold your garment. You are not able to see it, to make everything come to pass. You have to complete Christ. People of God, Christ is supposed to be completed to you. It doesn't matter the pain you go through. Joseph, he had to go through something I call the pain process. He had to be put into a pit. Next, he had to be put. He had to come to Potiphar's wife's house. Next, he has to go to prison. Yet, he has to come to palace. Next, he became the prime minister. Listen, until the first three peace were established, the last two wouldn't have come. If there's no prison, there's no prime minister. If there's no Potiphar's wife, there's no palace. And let me tell you something. This man, Joseph, that we are talking about, he's the chief hypologist of Christ. No one in history has had so many lineage like this uncle Joseph. Let me give you the similarities. Joseph had 11 brothers. Jesus, aside the one who betrayed him, Judas, had 11 disciples, right? Joseph was with his father Jacob. When the father sent him to go and give food to his brothers, they put him into a pit. Jesus was with his father. When the father sent him to come and give us eternal food, and we killed him. Now, Joseph had a name called Zabulapania, which means the Messiah. Jesus was also the Messiah. Now, when Joseph was in the prison, Bible said one person, the baker and the butler, one had life, the other one was killed. When Jesus was on the cross, one person had life, one person was killed. That's the cross. Let me continue, listen. Let me continue. Now, the garment of Jesus was torn into pieces. Joseph had his garment torn into pieces. Let me continue. Now, let me tell you something. When Jesus came, the very first one, the Jews never accepted him as their personal savior. But when the Antichrist suppresses them, then the Jews will get to know that this man who came as Christ is indeed their savior. What does it mean then? When the brothers of Joseph went to Egypt in the first time, they never saw that this was the brother that they sold into slavery. But upon the second time, when all God family got them, they saw that this was the brother that they sold into slavery. People of God, there's no one in history who can all God have a typology like that of Joseph. People of God, I'm here to announce unto you that the man, oh God, another one, listen. When Joseph was put into the pit, it was his brother Judah who said, let us not kill him. Let us sell for 30 pieces of silver. Now, when Jesus was being betrayed, it was the man Judas, a name that came from Judah, who said, let us sell him for 30 pieces of silver. Jesus, I'm here to declare to you that this man called Jehovah, he has come to take you and I out of that particular peace. People of God, you are sitting here as a prime minister, you are sitting here as a policeman. We have gone to the peace, we have gone to the wilderness, and we are coming out of the tomb. Say hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, you are Naomi. Listen to me carefully. You are Naomi. You found it difficult before paying your fees. It looks like half payment you made. God is saying that the help is coming. He's saying that the help is coming. Say amen. He's saying that the help is coming. Say amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let us go to 1 Corinthians 3. I hope I have a reader. My time, so I need someone coming for me fast. Or 1 Corinthians 3. But before you start to read, let me tell you something. Never say you are a student. So your work should be limited in the house of God. You enter into heaven not because you are a son. Let me put it this way. There is a 12-fold state of a believer. You are both a son and a servant. You see the five? The virgins. Five were foolish. Five were wise. Listen to me carefully. So that you not say that I'm a heretic. I'm teaching falsely. Listen. Five were foolish. Five were wise. The foolish ones saw the kingdom. They didn't enter. Please, what does John chapter 3 verse 3 say? John 3:3, what does it say? Oh, you can refer. John 3:3. Let's do it quick so we can continue. John 3:3, what does it say? Oh, voice out, please. What did he say? No one can see the kingdom of God unless born again. Read the verse 5.
Verily,
verily, I say unto you,
no one can enter.
No one can do what? So there's a difference between seeing and entering. Listen to me carefully. There are five. Thank you. God bless you. Oh, Jesus. Listen to me, You meet a man called Alex. Listen to me. You meet a man called Alex. Okay. And this particular man called Alex. I'll continue it now. I'm going to close. Okay. Listen. There's a seeing and there's entering. So the five foolish virgins, they saw the kingdom, they didn't do what? Enter. The wise virgins saw the kingdom and they entered as well. So there are most of us here, many of us here, who will see the kingdom, but will not enter. So many people take it from Egypt. Few of them saw Cana. It's a typology. Few of them saw Cana. So what qualification do you need to enter into the kingdom? What qualifications? Let's please read. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 11 to 15.
1 Corinthians 3:11-15.
Sure.
For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid.
For no one can lay a foundation other than the one which has been laid. Christ laid a foundation through his death and through his resurrection. That is the foundation we are talking about. Being made conformable unto his death. The foundation of Christ is his death and his subsequent resurrection. So you are not the person to die again for people to believe. But for no one can lay a foundation other than the one that Christ has laid. So that is the foundation. Please continue.
If anyone builds on this foundation.
If anyone builds, anyone who is about building first has to lay a foundation. So if anyone builds on this foundation, please continue.
Using gold.
Please listen. Using gold.
Silver.
Silver.
Costly stones.
Or precious stones.
Wood.
Wood.
Hay or straw.
Hay or straw.
Their work will be shown for what it is.
What is happening to the things you are building on? What is happening to them? Gold. Silver. Precious stones. Wood. Hay. Straw. What is happening to them? Complete degradation. With reduction in quality. Gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay. So you see, some people are here who are building with gold. Some people are also here who are building with wood. Straw. Please, I am not the one saying it's in scriptures. There is no other foundation that any other man can lay. So before you became a believer, Christ has laid the foundation. You are just supposed to come and build. Before I came here, the prophet was here. I was just supposed to come and preach. So I was not the one who put the prophet here. I hope you are following. And Bible said that you are building with either gold, diamond, precious stones. Sorry, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw. I will explain them as we go. Gold stands for divinity, something that is over divine. Silver stands for redemption. So the believer has to live a divine life after he has been redeemed. Precious stones talks about transformation. So you are being transformed. Now, who talks about humanity, things that are carnal, human things? Hey, and the rest talks about dead works, things whose foundation are not Christ. Please continue.
Their work will be shown for what it is.
Their works will be shown for what it is.
Because the day will bring it to
the
light.
The day, the judgment day will bring it to light.
It will be revealed with fire.
It will be revealed with fire. We are not going to light Mutia in heaven, then you put your things in it. No. We are not going to light any fire. In Revelation chapter 1 verse 14, the Bible said the eyes of Jesus is like a flaming fire. So Jesus will just pass his eyes through your things and we see which one will endure or which one will die. Please continue.
And the fire will test the quality of each person.
And the fire will test the quality. People of God, you can have 10 rooms, one city full each. Someone can only have one room, 50 gallons city full. That particular person will have money than the one who have 10 rooms in one city. So listen to me. Our works is not of the size, it is of the source. Say the source. Say the source. It is not the person who comes on television who is going to inherit the kingdom. You can be in your own closet, mind, yet you will be higher than Apostle Paul. So our works is not of the quantum, it's of the quality. Say quality.
Quality.
Bible said that the fire will test the source of what quality it is. Please continue.
If what has been built survives,
the
builder will receive a reward. If it is burned up,
The
builder will suffer loss, but yet will be saved.
The builder will suffer loss, yet will be saved. So many of us will be saved, yet we will not enter into the kingdom. What does it take to enter into the kingdom? Go to Matthew 7 for me. Matthew 7 for me. Please be fast.
Matthew chapter 7.
Verse 19 now.
verse 19.
Sure. Please, let's follow.
Matthew chapter 7, verse 19. If every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit you will recognize them. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven.
Will do what? So it's not seen. So people have been preaching this, that a gentleman can tell yourself, it's not about you going to hell. It is about you being denied of your crowns. You see, we first establish the difference between seeing the kingdom and entering the kingdom. So it's not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, Sir, they have already seen. Remember, in Acts chapter 2, verse 21, the Bible says, anyone who calleth upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So these people were saved. They said, Lord, 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 we casted demons in your name, we healed in your name. They were talking about their works. So they were saved by their works. Let's continue.
Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven.
Okay.
Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons.
So we are talking about your works. Please continue. Please hurry.
And in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles. Then I will tell them plainly.
Then I will tell them plainly.
I never knew you.
I never knew you. I never knew you. Not like, I don't know. Taking Yao, the vice president. That's not what he was talking about. I never knew you. The word there is, you know, so in which means I never allowed your works. I never had knowledge about your works. I never approved your works. So are your works approved? Jesus wanted us to know exactly what he meant. Those of you who are Bibles, see the very next verse that follows this particular verse. Bible said, anyone who therefore hears these words of mine and doeth them is likened unto who? A wise man who built his house where?
On a rock.
On a rock. Who is the rock? According to 1 Corinthians 10 verse 4, Christ is the rock. Right? So it means that the foundation was who? Was who? Christ. And Bible said, winds came. The flowers came. The winds and the flowers are talking about the judgment of God. And Bible said that his works, the building is his works. Remember in 1 Corinthians 10, the Bible said that we are building with this. His works are here. But Bible said, anyone who hears this word of mine and does not do them is likened unto whom? Foolish man. Remember the foolish virgins and the wise virgins. So the foolish and the wise has come again. It's wise is likened unto a foolish man who built his house where? Son. Good. Son talks about earthly works. Son talks about carnal works. 1 Corinthians 15 verse 45. Bible said, for the first man was of the earthy. Carnal works, first man, Adam. It means that your things are of Adam, not of Christ. And Bible said, when the winds came and everything came, remember, those two men didn't die. What happened to them? What happened to them? What happened to them? It was their buildings that they got. Collapse. One collapsed, one didn't collapse. So these two people will enter into the kingdom. But Bible said, we are seated with him in heavenly places. So our place are going to give up. Now ask yourself, ask the person sitting beside you, what are your works? Oh, I want to hear the answers. What are your works? What are your works? But what are your works? Christ said, when I call you, you shall no more be a fisherman, but you shall be fishers of men. People of God, the difference between the fisherman and the fishers of men, they are clear and they are distinct. It is as much as the difference between a lecturer and a potter. People of God, when we say someone is a fisherman, what it means is that this man catches fish that are alive and kill them. But when you say you are fishers of men, you take a man that is dead in Adam, and this particular man, you impart life unto this man. People of God, we are here to impart life unto dead people. We are here to give men life. We are here to give the life of God unto people. When you became a believer, you just not accepted Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, but you accepted him as your life. People of God, the ark of God left an old condemned Adamic world. It passed through water, and it rested on Mount Ararat. Ararat means curse, reverse. People of God, Christ is the ark. Tonight we are in the ark of God, which is his death. Tonight we are in the ark of God, which is his death. We have come with him, and we have moved with him. Bible says, do not be conformed to the things of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The word transform is metamorpho in Greek. What does it mean? In the same way that biology has taken, which is metamorphosis. What is metamorphosis? Hey, you know this particular animal